الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين. May blessings be from Allah and we seek help and refuge in Allah and we seek Allah's help to protect us from the evil of our own doing and the bad things that we do to ourselves. The doctor has mentioned a hadith that is in Sahih al-Bukhari and he mentioned it two times. The matn of the hadith, the wording of the hadith goes الخيل في نواصيها الخير إلى يوم القيامة, which translates into horses have got all goodness lying on the foreheads of the horse until the day of judgment. And another isnad, the same hadith, the horses have got goodness lying on its forehead until the day of judgment. And the third time the sheikh has mentioned the hadith, blessing is in the forehead of the horses. And the horses here is mentioned to denote the fact that it's being used as a tool in battles. معك الله خلق الحبيب. The Bukhari, Imam Bukhari rahmahullah has chapterized this under a certain chapter talking about the main tool of war, which was the horses at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and it has been going on like that for quite a long time. Allah says in the Quran, وَعُدُّوا لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَرِبَاطِ الْخَيْلِ تُرْهِبُونَ بِهِ عَدُوَّ اللَّهِ وَعَدُوَّكُمْ, which translates into prepare for them all you can from strength and equipment to terrorize the enemy of Allah and your enemy. The preparation for war is something that Sharia has made as a necessity for people to take care, take into consideration in their lifetime. And it's a farz on Muslims to prepare. And this preparation is not only by making available weapons for war, but also psychologically and financially. The Muslim has to prepare the tool with which to fight. The Sheikh has mentioned it as dabba, which is the transportation method that you use while fighting, which is going to be riding while fighting. And in our day, nowadays, we have many other things that we have to use, not only horses, but also anything that comes into the main category, مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ, anything you can. Anything the Muslim can afford to get within his armory with which he can fight, he has to make available. Either this is by self-made in a Muslim country, or by having a contract with a kafir country, an infidel country, but given that this tool has to be known very well by the Muslim. The Muslim has to be very well acquainted with how to use that weapon. If he doesn't know how to use it and it's up to the kafir only to control how the weapon's being used, then this is not good enough. You have to know exactly how you can use it. The command of Allah to prepare this force according to the abilities of each and every Muslim has also got the connection of khayl, of horses, in Sabilillah. This is not only from the time of the Quran, but also it goes on with ages according to the needs of Muslims and the development of weapons. There is actually, until now, in every single number, there is one section, battalion called the Silah al-Fursan. I don't know how to translate that one. It's the horse riders. The battalion is called the horse riders. And in that battalion is used because there are places which can never be reached unless you're actually going on a horse, like in a mountain. And this has been proven in Afghanistan, where the horses have been playing a very major part in the fighting of everyday battle in Afghanistan. You cannot, the next point is, we cannot claim that the keeping the horses at home, feeding them and preparing them for war is something that we don't need anymore. This is not true. Because in every army in the world now, there are horsemen and there are horses that are being used. The Prophet ﷺ, he talked about the later times, he said that he knew the people who will fight, he knows their names, he knows the names of those mujahideen, and the names of their horses, and actually the colors of their horses, which is a proof enough for everybody that the horses will be used until the day of judgment, as said in the Quran. The Prophet ﷺ said in one version of the hadith, he said الخير في نواصبها الخير إلى يوم القيامة. The goodness is in the foreheads of horses until the day of judgment. And in another version, it says محقوب في نواصبها الخير, is tied to the forehead rather than just in the forehead. And in other versions, قيل وفيها الأجر والمغنم, which means that in this forehead there is the reward and the loot which Muslims will get as a result of fighting. The brother has said that the Prophet has mentioned that goodness is in the forehead of the horses until the day of judgment, and by that he meant the horses which are being prepared and held for being used in jihad. There is another hadith which says that the horses are for one of three men, رجل أجر, رجل ستر, رجل نذر. For one man it's a reward, for one man it's a cover, and for one man it's a sin. The one who gets rewarded for is the one who keeps it for jihad, to be used in fighting later on. So the one for whom it's wizr is the one who kept it ajran wa bataran, who kept it just to show up and to make it a property of his that he would be proud with to show to people in shows and things like that. For the third man it's sitr, and for this man is the one who keeps it for trade if he sells it later on to make a profit out of selling it. So the goal behind this hadith is that really the horse which is an ajr is the one that is being kept for jihad. The word in nawasi has five. Nawasi is the plural of nasiya, and the nasiya is the forehead of the horse, and it's the front bit of the forehead of the horse. The horses are well known for having long forehead hairs on the forehead, which make them beautiful. And that the owners of the horses give care to this part of the head. And in as a language, the nasiya is an honorable place. It's very high. For example, for a man, his forehead is the topmost bit of his body. Allah says in the Quran, يؤخذ بالنواصي والأقدام. And also he says, لئن لم ينتهي لنتبعن بالنواصي. The nasiya is being used because it's the most honorable bit of the body, and it means the whole of the body, which brings us into another issue. I would like to use the Arabic word for it, majaz. This is called majaz. The people of knowledge call majaz, say that majaz is acceptable in Quran and Sunnah, because the Quran came in the pure Arabic language. And it's a matter of idioms. It's being used both in the Quran and Sunnah, and there is it's trying to tell that the word you use can be used to denote something that is larger than just the simple front top part explanation of it. In the context of what we're talking about, the using the word forehead, we are actually denoting the whole part of the body. This has been taken by other sections, sects who have deviated from Islam, and they try to use this in the sifat, in the properties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We as Ahl Sunnah Jama'ah, we use our own view of it is that we give the description of Allah that they are not similar in any way to the description of His created creatures without any making any tashbih or ta'til between what we refer to as Allah and what we refer to as the creatures of Allah. In our hadith here, there is a place where a majaz can be brought in, because what if a horse does not have any hair on the top, or anything like that. There is actually a hadith in Abu Dawood, and Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, do not cut the hair on the forehead of the horses or its tails. But this hadith is da'if, it's a weak hadith, it's not authentic, and it doesn't prove anything. But some people say we'd rather not cut the hair of the horses, just to be on the safe side, rather than getting into the mess of what the knowledge seekers and the knowledgeable people do. The Prophet has said, the horses have the goodness in the forehead. The goodness here, as in the wording of the hadith, is been explained as the reward and the loot which you would gain after defeating the enemy. The horses in general are being used as, can be named as goodness because of the blessings that is within them. Sulaiman alayhi salam has said in the Quran, إني أحببت حب الخير. حب الخير here, I loved loving the goodness. The goodness here is another alternative word for khayr. And therefore the word khayr, which is goodness, and the word khayr, which is horses, have always been connected together, unless in one instance. There's a hadith from the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. He says that optimism, if it is in anything, then it is in three: in horses, in women, and in house. A lot of scholars have talked about this, and there's been a debate going on about it, but apparently it seems that these three have been taken off as exclusions from the Prophet's command not to be pessimistic. The Prophet says never ever be pessimistic, but with these three you can be pessimistic. That's indicated with women who have bad manners. If a woman has bad manners or cannot have children, then this is one thing that you can be pessimistic about. It's a bad thing that will never go. It will be there forever. Also, if you live in a very small house where there is a very bad neighbor and he will never go, that neighbor, then this is one of the things that you should be pessimistic about. It's okay for you to feel pessimistic about. And also, if you have horses that you don't use for jihad or for trade, then this is one of the bad things, that its results will harm you in dunya, in life, and in the hereafter as well. This is what pessimism can be used, and without any contradiction with the hadith that we have from the Prophet ﷺ, never to be pessimistic about anything.
Alright, salam alaikum. The hadith is narrated in Bukhari by Awrah al-Baraqi, and the English of it is the Prophet ﷺ said, good will remain, brackets, as a permanent quality in the foreheads of horses for jihad to the day of resurrection, for they bring about either a reward in the hereafter or beauty in this world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inshallah, I'm going to read the hadith again, just as a reminder. Narrated by Awrah al-Baraqi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, good will remain as a permanent quality in the foreheads of horses for jihad to the day of resurrection, for they bring about either a reward in the hereafter or a booty in this world. From this hadith, al-Bukhari has gotten a point from another perspective, or you could say another explanation for this hadith. And it shows the main point, or the Shaykh talks about the main point of, or that can be derived from the hadith, is that jihad will remain and will be constant until the day of judgment. And during that period of time, there'll be evil leaders, there'll be evil or transgressors as leaders of ours, as khulafa, and there'll be good khulafa. However, under both, jihad will remain constant. And the point to understand here is that from Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, jihad, we're talking about offensive jihad, it's still fought even if the leader is a transgressor, right? Even if the leader is a transgressor, offensive jihad is still there because it brings about da'wah and there's lots of benefit. But we're not talking about the fard ayn, because fard ayn, which means the defensive jihad, whether the Khalifa is a transgressor, whether he's a good person or not, does not matter about with regard to the Khalifa, the jihad is still there and everybody has to participate. But the issue again is whether we can fight under a transgressor Khalifa or not. And from this hadith we see that jihad will remain until the day of judgment. And therefore, no matter what the head is, offensive jihad is still there and defensive jihad is still there. And let's see. Another hadith which the Shaykh mentioned, he mentions about the Prophet ﷺ saying that there'll be ashab, a group of people who will continue fighting on the true path until the day of judgment, which is another hadith to support the fact that offensive and defensive jihad can be fought still. And the main point is that offensive jihad is still fought even if the Khalifa is bad or not, because jihad is, like we said, until the day of judgment. In Ibn Taymiyyah, he says, the Shaykh quotes Ibn Taymiyyah and he says that for most of the time that the Muslims have lived under, there's been a bad a ruling. For most of the Islamic rule, there was a bad ruler, there was not a good ruler, or the transgressors and Balimun, and you know, they're not very good. And if we were to say that just because they're bad, there's no more offensive jihad, then that is batil, that is not true, that is not right, because that means there will be no more da'wah. Because jihad has many benefits, and one of them is da'wah for people to come to Islam. And so if we were just to say, okay, he's a bad leader, he loves jihad, then that is just, it's not right. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, that is the full translation insha'Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take me away from the riyah and take me to the السلام عليكم. The hadith is narrated by Abu Hurairah. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if somebody keeps a horse in Allah's cause, motivated by his faith in Allah and his belief in his promise, then he will be rewarded on the day of resurrection for what the horse has eaten or drunk and for its dung and urine. The hadith is narrated by Abu Hurairah and it says, inshallah, I'm going to repeat it again. If somebody keeps a horse in Allah's cause motivated by his faith in Allah and his belief in his promise, then he will be rewarded on the day of resurrection for what the horse has eaten or drunk and for its dung and urine. First of all, the Shaykh was saying that this is a hadith that summarizes that longer hadith which was narrated by Abu Hurairah, the narrator who narrates this hadith. That hadith talks about how there's three different kinds of keepers of horses, right? And one of them is evil, the other one, Allahu A'lam, I forget. But the one that we want to focus on is the person who keeps the horse for ajr, the keeps for reward. And basically this talks exactly about the reward that she received from keeping a horse for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it shows that you can use anything, not just you or a horse or a weapon, in order to uphold the truth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you notice, or if you focus on the, it says, if somebody keeps a horse in Allah's cause motivated by his faith, this is a dalil. This is a dalil, a proof that amal, the good deed, works are connected to iman, right? They both go hand in hand, right? This is, it shows that there's a strong connection between amal and iman. If you do not have amal, if you do not have iman, then there is no point of doing amal, because it will not be accepted since you don't have iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they go hand in hand. And also expecting a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they go hand in hand. And You can't just, force here is an example, right? But it can be, this hadith can also be applied to other things. It can be applied to other things that you keep for the sake of Allah in order to use it in the path of Allah. So this can be used for a weaponry, as an example. This can be used for a weaponry, you keep it for the sake of Allah. You're cleaning of it and all of that, similar to the horse. And at the end of this hadith, it is very important how much of a reward there is. It says you'll be rewarded on the day of resurrection for what the horse has eaten or drunk, and for its dung and urine. So whatever the horse has caused, or whatever you have, you know, whatever comes out of the horse, and whatever you have to feed the horse, whatever maintenance you have to do. So similarly, you can apply this on whatever thing you keep for the sake of Allah, and you maintain it. And inshallah, you'll be rewarded for it. And the Shaykh also mentioned another verse earlier about keeping the horses for the sake of Allah, but I do not have the translation of it, so I won't mention it. But inshallah, the Shaykh was saying that basically we will, this is the last hadith that we're doing in this circle today, and inshallah, we will do it again Sunday. And it's regarding the first hadith that we will discuss on that day is regarding the naming of the horse. And inshallah, we will meet same time on Sunday, this Sunday. There was a question regarding jihad, offensive jihad. He was asking, did the Shaykh say that you can fight offensive jihad under a tyrant ruler? And the Shaykh said, yes. And to clarify, yes, you can fight under a tyrant or a good person offensive jihad. But as to whether defensive jihad, it doesn't matter about the imam, whatever his condition is. If it's defensive, then it's obligation, it doesn't matter, there's nothing. And inshallah, that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, and that's the answer to it. The Shaykh was saying that inshallah, we'll open the floor for questions regarding the topic jihad. And inshallah, after that, after those questions, we take care of them, then inshallah, we're going to open for a general. Shaykh Al-Huni, he was saying that that question as to how we can apply this hadith today, where horses are not used as much. He said that there was an extensive and elaborate answer in the beginning of this discussion. So I want the answer inshallah download it off farhuni.com and it will be up inshallah in 2 days. So inshallah the answer to that is the full extensive answer.